The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I'm Pastor Liz. This is Pastor Dexter. And we want to welcome you to Longview Presbyterian Church this morning. We are a community of faith that is seeking Christ's way and welcoming all people. And we're so glad that you are here. Many of us are feeling invigorated after yesterday's Poor People's Campaign March on Washington, which some of us watched right here on the live stream in the sanctuary. You can see some of the paraments that are on the table and at the pulpit, reminding us of our mission to follow Jesus in fighting poverty, not the poor. We will bless the care kits that you see on the table later in the service. They are just a small representation of the over 60 care kits that we made that are resting upstairs. We thank God today for the prophetic witness of the Poor People's Campaign and the ways that we feel called right here in our own community to speak truth to power. We plan to have our usual fellowship Zoom gathering this week for you to stay connected to your church family, Tuesday, 7 p.m. on our regular church Zoom link for a time of fellowship, prayer, and usually laughter. So everyone is welcome. It's a great way to stay connected. This coming Wednesday, we have a special event from the People of Faith for Abortion Rights group. That'll be this Wednesday, June 22nd at 6 p.m. on our church Zoom link. Following an initial Zoom meeting that happened on May 18th of this year to brainstorm ways people of faith in Cowlitz County can advocate for equitable abortion access for all, a subgroup of that gathering was then tasked to explore ways we could respond if and when the provisions of Roe versus Wade are overturned by the Supreme Court. Laws in Washington and Oregon will continue to protect reproductive health, but there is still much to be done for residents as well as those seeking services from other states. So we invite anyone who wants to, you don't even have to have come to the first meeting, to join this Wednesday, June 22nd at 6 p.m., the regular church Zoom link, for a status report and a working discussion from that smaller team who's been working on a strategy for our area. So don't miss that time together. Everyone is welcome. I would now like to invite Sheldon to come forward to lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning. Come, let us worship. The artists, the queer folks, the children.
The workers, the water protectors, the mourners.
The outraged, the caregivers, the organizers.
Each of the winds of God.
Amidst a world groaning with destruction.
The living God.
Not at a distance, but dwelling right here among us.
The Spirit is poured out.
I now invite you to stand as you are able to sing along with our opening hymn, number 20, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
That opens, each little bird that sings. God made their glowing colors, God made their tiny wings. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The purple-headed mountain, the river running by, the sunset and the morning that brightens up the sky. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The cold wind in the winter, the pleasant summer sun, the ripe fruits in the garden, God made them everyone. All things wide and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, and lips that we might tell how great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things and wonderful, the Lord God made them all.
You may be seated. It is time for our kids' story time. So whether you're at home on Zoom or joining in person or watching a recording later, this kids' time is for you. Today, we find Jesus in a place called the Gerasenes, where a man comes out to meet him right after Jesus gets off a boat. We don't know exactly what this means, but the story says that the man who came to Jesus had demons, which made it hard for him to live. When he met Jesus, he had no clothes, and instead of living in a house, he was living in a graveyard. People in the town nearby kept him chained up. Jesus met this man, and he told the demons to go away, and it worked. Now the man was free to feel better and to feel like himself again. When the people of the nearby town saw this man back to his old self, the same people who had chained him up and not let him anywhere near their town, they were afraid of him. At this time, Jesus was about to get back on the boat and leave when this man came to Jesus and said, "Please, please let me go with you." But Jesus said to him, "I want you to go back to your home and tell those people in the town nearby how much God has done for you." So this man who had been set free went back to that town and he told them all about what Jesus had done for him. The people in that town were afraid of this man when he had these bad things happen to him. And because they were afraid, because they were scared, they chained him up and they kicked him out of their town. But Jesus doesn't want anyone to be chained up or thrown away. Jesus wants every single person to feel alive and to feel like themselves, to know that they are loved exactly the way they are. And Jesus especially wants each person to have people around them who will care for them and love them and support them. We are called to act like Jesus, to love people and care for them instead of chaining them up and throwing them away. We are called to be like Jesus and to connect every person to a community who can let them know how very loved they are. I invite anyone who wants to join me in a repeat after me prayer. God who breaks chains, you never throw people away. Help us to always welcome people and give them what they need to live, so we can all be part of one community. Filled with your love. Amen. At this time, trusting in the mercy of God, we confess our sin before God and one another. And we begin that time of confession by inviting any who wish to confess together the reality that we worship on land, on earth, that white settlers stole from indigenous people. In the world that is coming, injustices are made right, and the earth is treated like a beloved member of our family. As we speak this land acknowledgement, let us follow it up with actions that hasten the coming of this kingdom of God. It is vital to honor those who came before us and acknowledge the long history of what is now Southwest Washington State. This area has been home to ancestors of the Cowlitz Indian tribe for thousands of years. The land, with its rich resources, enabled the Cowlitz people to flourish, and they stewarded the land with their traditional culture. Today, we must appreciate the persistence of the Cowlitz people and the important role they play in our region, as together we steward the land for all our descendants. We continue our prayer of confession. Merciful and gracious God, we walk in a way that is not good. We follow our own devices. We ignore your image in ourselves and in our neighbors. Do not turn away from us, O God, but hear our cry for blessing. Lead us out of the tombs we inhabit. Guide us into your light so that we may walk in your way. Amen. Beloved, you belong to Christ and are heirs in the promise of freedom. In full assurance of justification by grace through faith, by the authority of God's beloved Son, I declare to you the absolute forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Blessed Trinity, one God, amen. It's that time of the service when we pass the peace of Christ to one another. So we can start by doing that in sign language. You can turn to the people around you to pass the peace of Christ to them. LPC family, may the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. You may now pass the peace. I now invite Sheldon forward to read the prayer for illumination and the first reading of Scripture.
As you spoke to the legions, O God, speak now to the forces that surround us. By your Spirit, let your word illumine the darkness, and your light break through our delusions, that we may see your truth. Amen. The first reading is found in Isaiah 65, verses 1 through 9. I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask, to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am, here I am, to a nation that did not call on my name. I held out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good, following their own devices, a people who provoke me to my face continually, sacrificing in gardens and offering incense on bricks, who sit inside tombs and spend the night in secret places, who eat swine's flesh with broth of abominable things in their vessels, who say, keep to yourself, do not come near me, for I am too holy for you. These are a smoke in my nostrils, a fire that burns all day long. See, it is written before me, I will not keep silent, but I will repay. I will indeed repay into their laps their inequities and their ancestors' inequities together, says the Lord. Because they offered incense on the mountains and reviled me on the hills, I will measure into their laps full payment for their actions. Thus says the Lord, as the wine is found in the cluster, and they say, do not destroy it, for there is a blessing in it. So I will do for my servants' sake and not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob and from Judah, inheritors of my mountains. My chosen shall inherit it, and my servants shall settle there. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading this morning comes to us from the gospel according to Luke, the 8th chapter, verses 26 through 39. Then they arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite of Galilee. As he, Jesus, stepped out on land, a man of the city who had demons met him. For a long time, he had worn no clothes, and he did not live in a house, but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, but he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the wilds. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. They begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swine herds saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened. And when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The dictionary defines a scapegoat as a person who is blamed for the wrongdoings, mistakes, or faults of others, especially for reasons of expediency. This phrase, of course, originated from the Leviticus commands in the Bible about the removal of sins from the nation of Israel. In the Bible, a scapegoat came from a pair of goats, one which was sacrificed — this was not the scapegoat — and the other goat, which was released into the wilderness, carrying the sins of the community away. That was the scapegoat. In our gospel story this morning, we see a man scapegoated by his community. He is sent into the wilderness so that the community does not have to see the way that they have failed to support him. This Gerasene man, of course, has spiritual, emotional, and physical issues. And his community kicks him out, making him a scapegoat rather than dealing with the systemic issues. And believe it or not, this is a common occurrence in our world today. Communities scapegoat the problems of the community onto individuals or onto a small group in order not to deal with them themselves. How many political arguments do we hear in our country over immigration as the reason for why the United States has issues, instead of maybe dealing with healthcare or education? How has our community scapegoated the unhoused by pushing them into the corner of our city, out of sight, out of mind, instead of dealing with the actual problem, which is a lack of housing, a lack of jobs, a lack of resources? The problem with scapegoating as a way to deal with our issues is that it never actually addresses the systemic issues that we have. White supremacy, homophobia, racialized capitalism, wealth hoarding, climate change. But as Christians, we follow Jesus. And if you look closely at the gospel, Jesus is the one who is always searching for and finding the scapegoats, the outcasts, the oppressed, and sides with them. In fact, Jesus sides with the scapegoats so much that he becomes the ultimate scapegoat on the cross, in which we are called to never scapegoat any other person. So, what is the antidote to our scapegoating culture? And I think it's twofold if we look at this story. First, Jesus comes calmly to the Gerasene man who screams at Jesus saying, "What do you have to do with me? I beg you, do not torment me." How often is the oppressed person's reaction to Christianity in our culture saying, "Do not torment me"? They see the Christian coming to help them and assume that we will torment them, forcing a patronizing worldview on them or telling them they need to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. But Jesus doesn't do any of that. Jesus bucks this trend and instead addresses the high stress of this man in a very non-anxious and non-threatening way by simply and tenderly asking, "What is your name?" Often, interpretations of this passage don't extend this care or this grace to this man until after the exorcism. But Jesus doesn't wait to care for this man. Jesus perceives him immediately as a sympathetic human being who has been cast out of his community. Jesus does not wait for healing before caring for him. Jesus does not wait for him to be off of drugs, to fix his mental illness, to find a house before coming to care for him. Jesus goes to him exactly as he is and starts that relationship. "What is your name?" Jesus asks this question, I would guess, with probably more affection and care than that man had received in a long time. In the words of theologian Damon Garcia, the stories of Jesus's exorcisms are stories of Jesus reaching out to those who are dehumanized and rehumanizing them. Jesus seeks to free those being tormented and dehumanized on the margins of society. And today, we are called to follow in Jesus's footsteps, to build relationships with those who are scapegoated, those who are outcast, those who are oppressed and marginalized. And I think the second step, the second antidote to ending scapegoating is by our working together to end the interlocking systems of oppression that keep people down, that throw people away, that commit violence to the most needy. Yesterday, a group of people gathered here in our sanctuary to virtually join the national March on Washington with the Poor People's Campaign. We gathered to demand change from our political officials. We demanded change because, in the words of the march, there are 140 million people who were poor or one emergency away from economic ruin before the pandemic. And since March 2020, while hundreds of thousands of people have died, millions are on the edge of hunger and eviction and still without healthcare or living wages, while billionaire wealth has grown by over $2 trillion. We sat here in this sanctuary, we watched the March on Washington, and we put together support kits. Support kits to care for our unhoused neighbors at the Alabama Street encampment. It was one step for our community, for our church, to start building relationships across class lines by uniting our liberation with the liberation of everyone, by following Jesus into this community of care and a kingdom of love and healing for all. When we finally stop scapegoating, we will discover that the issues we put on those individuals are actually the issues of our whole community. Following Jesus requires us to go out to the margins, to go out to the edges of our community and to build relationships. We must move beyond our church walls and into the world that is in desperate need of this relationship, this solidarity. And by rehumanizing and building relationships, we start to follow the way of Jesus. And then by working to end those systems of oppression, we begin to bring forth the world that Jesus died to create, heaven on earth. So let us, as those who are seeking Christ's way, follow this path that Jesus has laid before us and build a better world together. Amen?
Amen.
Friends, I invite you to stand as you are able for our responding hymn, number 182 in your hymnal, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say.
I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Lay down, O weary one, lay down your head upon my breast. I came to Jesus as I was, so weary, worn, and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. I heard the voice of Jesus say, behold, I freely give the living water, thirsty one, stoop down and drink and live. I came to Jesus and I drank of that life-giving stream. My thirst was quenched, my soul revived, and now I live in him. I heard the voice of Jesus say, I am left this dark world's light. Look unto me, your morn shall rise, and all your day be bright. I looked to Jesus, and I found in him my star, my sun. And in that light of life I'll walk till traveling days are gone.
You may be seated. We continue our worship in prayer, sharing our joys and concerns through the chat function if you're online. You can also send your prayers to the pastors in advance, and we'll incorporate those in here. We also have a prayer sheet at the front entrance to our sanctuary where you can write down prayers that you might have. And we are returning to sharing prayers aloud during worship. A pastor will walk around with the microphone. If you raise your hand, share your name, share your prayer request into the microphone, please, so that everyone can hear. And then the pastor will pray for you, or I'll read one of our prayers, or one of the prayers will be said somewhere from the sanctuary. I will close, or Pastor Liz will close each prayer with, God, in your grace, we invite you all to respond, you receive our prayers, O God. Once the prayers have concluded, we'll have a prayer of silence for those prayer concerns that might feel too heavy to be spoken openly this morning. We know that God receives those prayers, the deepest cries of our hearts. We're going to open our prayer time today with a written history and prayer from the Presbyterian Mission Agency in celebration of Juneteenth, June 19th, which is today. And many of us gathered yesterday to commemorate at Victoria Freeman Park, a space that our city has dedicated to the Black woman responsible for leading the integration of schools here in Longview. Victoria Freeman is one of the matriarchs of LPC elder Cynthia Madsen Washington's family, and we invoke her name with today with reverence and a commitment to follow in her footsteps. So, Juneteenth is a blend of the words June and 19th. It is an American holiday commemorating the end of slavery in the United States. Despite the Emancipation Proclamation issued by President Lincoln on September 22, 1862, freedom did not come to those still held in bondage in the resistant state of Texas until Union Major General Gordon Granger rode into Galveston on June 19, 1865 with 2,000 federal troops. With the announcement, the newly freed people flooded the streets in jubilant celebration. Juneteenth, known also as Freedom Day, was launched the following year. Juneteenth serves as a chronological turning point in the American drama about the triumph of the human spirit over the cruelty of slavery. Juneteenth is a time to pause and remember those African-American descendants who suffered and died, and to honor those who survived as living witnesses to the inhumane institution of slavery. It is a time to venerate the shining legacy of resistance and resilience of oppressed people, and to recommit ourselves again and again to the work of dismantling white supremacy in every place that we find it, in our country, in our communities, and in our own hearts and bodies. So let us pray in solidarity with our African-American siblings this day. Thank you, O God, for your grace and redeeming love. Today we commemorate with joy and thanksgiving the shouts of enslaved people in Texas who at last heard a declaration of freedom. And we ask you to hear our cries for a swift end to slavery wherever it exists today. Give us the strength to follow your creative will, to land on that peaceful shore where the gifts of mutuality, reciprocity, and justice are equally shared. God, in your grace, you receive our prayers, O God. Have any prayers from the congregation?
I like the prayers in celebration. My nephew, Gary Ferguson, went into surgery on Friday, and they replaced the valve and did two bypasses. And he's in recovery now and responding well.
Good. We praise you, God, that Gary, the Robertson's nephew, came through his heart surgery successfully. We pray for continued recovery, health, and a return to his life. We pray that you'd surround that family with your peace. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. We're going to continue our time with a Father's Day litany, which is written by an unknown UMC pastor for the blog Pulpit Fiction. We know that today, Father's Day, for some, this is a celebration, a day filled with joy. And for others, this might be a day of trauma or complicated emotions. So let us lift up whatever we are experiencing on this day to our God who is holding all of us. Loving and merciful God, whose power is beyond our scope and whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, we turn to you in faith, assured that you know our every emotion and are aware of our every need. Our thoughts and prayers today are turned towards our fathers. For those whose fathers have increased the joy in their lives, we give you thanks. For those whose fathers' presence is greatly missed, may we take time to gratefully recall all they have given to us, providing for us in our growing. For those who have recently lost their fathers or who are facing that loss imminently, may they find comfort in their grief, hope in their despair, courage in the love that their fathers have given them. We give thanks, God, for those good men who sustain and support us in our living, who love us no matter what. What a blessing they are to all who know them. We give you thanks, O God, for all those whose gift for fatherhood is so strong that they have allowed their caring to spill over into the lives of others, providing the guidance and stability, the nurture and the love needed. How distressing it is for us to consider that not all fathers have been good fathers. We pray, compassionate God, for those whose father has been a source of hurt and pain, for all those for whom one or more members of their family has caused them to suffer. May their wounds be healed. We recall with sadness fathers who are separated from their children through life choices made by them or made by others. Give them the insight and wisdom, the courage and perseverance to parent in whatever creative and life-giving ways are open to them. We remember today all those who are parenting alone, working to provide all the emotional, physical, and spiritual needs without the constant support of a partner. May they find the strength, the courage, and wisdom for their task. We pray for those fathers whose relationships with their children have been difficult or disappointing. And we pray too for those who have been denied a chance to be fathers, and for those whose years of parenting have been cut short by the loss of a child. We turn to you, most holy God, knowing, trusting that you can console where consolation seems impossible. Present parent, hold each person in the way they need to be held on this day. We trust you to hold the multitudes of all we feel. Hear our prayers this day, O God, and give to us such assurance of your love that your love may spill forth from us into the lives of others. God, in your grace, you receive our prayers, O God.
Well, I do have a prayer request, but first I have to make note of something. When I sat down and picked up the hymnal that was on the chair this morning, I think it's the first time that it's happened, but I happened to have the inside cover open, and it was presented by me in memory of Alice Erickson, one of the saints of Longview Presbyterian. My prayer request is for the family of my son-in-law, Anthony Laudato. Anthony's dad is nearing his final days, his dad, George. Anthony, Lisa, and Anthony's son, Luca, are flying back to the East Coast tomorrow to say goodbye.
Let us pray. Consoling God, we pray today for Anthony and his whole family as they travel to say goodbye to his father, George, particularly on this Father's Day weekend. Hold them in your care as they weep and process and share memories and try their best to say goodbye. Hold them very close to your heart. God, in your grace,
you receive our prayers, O God.
Got some chat prayers coming in. Holy One, we pray with Jim and Judy McLeod for the ministry of the Fish Food Bank this week that will happen in our own sanctuary. We pray that the communion table we have here would be so abundant that it spreads to the tables of our neighbors. We pray for love and a sense of connection and dignity to surround each person who comes through our doors needing food. God, in your grace,
you receive our prayers, O God.
We pray also for Betty as she seeks care for her back this coming week. We pray that you would bring healing and restoration, relief from pain, and that you would hold Betty close as she seeks to find this healing. God, in your grace,
you receive our prayers, O God. We continue praying in our 50th year, a prayer for our church's ongoing anti-racist education and action. Holy One, in a world dominated by systems of oppression and white supremacy, We lament the roles we have played, and we seek to continue growing and building new ways of being. Help us to follow your spirit, Holy One, into building justice and bringing forth your kingdom. God, in your grace,
you receive
our prayers, O God. We have more prayers from the congregation.
I have a prayer that acknowledges that this is Gay Pride Month. The annual conference of the Florida United Methodist Church met earlier this month, and the Board of Ordained Ministry recommended the class that was to be candidates for ministry. That's a first step in the United Methodist tradition. However, that recommendation had to be voted on by the entire group of elders, the clergy who were gathered. And with a margin of 7 votes, they voted not to accept these candidates for ministry because 2 of them were from the LGBTQ community. It's very sad to report this, but I think it's an awareness that is important to have. We are not there yet, and we certainly need to continue to pray for our brothers and sisters and for those who have committed themselves to ministry and as a class were denied this. So I want to pray for those folks. And I want you to know too that the Board of Ordained Ministry of our conference and the Oregon-Idaho conference together wrote to the boom, what we called it, in Florida, expressing their concern and sympathy for this recommendation that did not pass.
God of justice, in this Pride Month, we join Sharon in praying for our United Methodist siblings, particularly over the decision in Florida not to ordain these LGBTQ folks who you have called into your ministry. We pray for their broken hearts, for the ways they carry that kind of trauma in their bodies. And we thank you for all those in the United Methodist tradition, folks like Sharon and beyond, who dissent to this kind of injustice, especially when we find it in our own traditions. We pray for a way forward that truly includes all of your children. God, in your grace,
you receive our prayers, O God. Any more in the chat? We continue with a prayer of silence to share those concerns that just feel too heavy to be spoken out loud. Let us pray. God, in your grace, you receive our prayers, O God. We pray together now to our parenting God, Mother and Father, as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The poet Khalid Matawa asks, now that you've come out of hiding, why would we live again in the tombs we'd made out of our souls? Friends, may our souls be resurrected from any tombs we have made. May we co-create a world so safe and so loving that there be no reason to hide in fear. Today, we gather our shared resources that it may be so. To open our time of offering, we're going to invite Darcy forward to bless the care kits that were created yesterday for our unhoused siblings at the Alabama Street encampment. We have a few of the kits here, but there's actually over 60 kits, which is filling up our upstairs office that we put together that will be distributed in the coming days and weeks. We put these together during our Poor People's Campaign March on Washington, and we want to send them with our love and prayers of solidarity to be distributed at the camp. All who feel led can stretch out a hand toward the kits as we bless them and recommit ourselves to the work of solidarity with those who do not have housing. Darcy, would you like to lead the blessing?
Holy Parent, we hear the cries of our siblings whose voices often go unheard and ignored. They are wounded and in need of care. May these kits be our way of telling them, you are seen, you are worthy, you are loved, and a small way of binding their wounds and healing their hearts, which have been broken and bruised. We bring these kits as an offering of love and care to our siblings who are hurting. Bless the hands that lovingly and carefully assembled them, those who will distribute them to our siblings, and especially bless those who will receive them. Help them know that they are seen, deserving of care, beloved and loved as they are. We seek this, we ask this in your powerful and compassionate name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Darcy, for writing, sharing, and for organizing with the Poor People's Campaign to make this happen. Today, we are going to be reintroducing the passing of the plate during our offertory. This practice, of course, stopped in 2020 due to the possible transmission of COVID, but we are excited to be able to bring it back. The passing of the plate is an option for you during the church service to give financially to sustain our ministry. It's not a requirement of anyone, and we recognize that each one of you gives in more ways than just through financial means. And we want to celebrate those actions with great joy as well. And of course, you can continue to give via mail or online on our website if that works best for you. We recognize that this is a time of increased financial stress for so many. If you are in need of any financial assistance, no matter how big or small, please do not hesitate to contact your deacon. You can also contact the whole deacons via email at the new deacon email address, which is longviewdeacons@gmail.com. Or of course, you can call the deacons on their new phone line, which is 360-747-7136 to start that process. We would really love to support you in this tangible way. We invite you now to consider all the gifts you've given this week as we enjoy an offertory from our church musician, Noel Carlston, and then we will sing the doxology together. Thank you. Living Christ, free our spirits of any kernel of revenge and cruelty. Direct us instead toward collective repair and right action. When we feel ourselves slipping into apathy and despair, place your hands on either side of our face and gaze upon us with your connecting love. Bless our offerings to our hard-earned hope toward everyday resurrection. Amen. I invite you to join us for our sending hymn, number 318, In Christ There Is No East or West.
In Christ there is no east or west, in him no south or north. Yet one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide earth. In Christ shall true hearts everywhere their hot communion find. His service is the golden cord close binding humankind. Joined hands, disciples of the faith, whate'er your race may be, all children of the living God are surely kin to me. In Christ now meet both east and west, in him meet south and north. All Christly souls are one in him throughout the whole wide earth.
You may be seated. Friends, thank you so much for joining us at Longview Presbyterian Church. For those in person, we will not have an inside fellowship time, but we invite you to keep your masks on and join us outside the building if you'd like to chat. If you're joining us on Zoom and want to partake in some virtual fellowship, just stay online after the postlude for connection. Now receive this benediction. Through the witnessing of beauty, may we encounter wonder. Through the tenderness of kind relationships, may we experience care. In our anger over injustice, may we connect with courageous action. In all the ordinary aches and joys of being alive, the presence of God is with us. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. We invite everyone to enjoy a live postlude from our church musician, Noel, as we close our time together. Darcy, our acolyte, will carry the light of Christ out into the world, reminding us to follow Christ in the work of being God's people wherever we go.